on the blood and lymphatic vessels of the skin. Remember, we've already pointed out that the epidermis is an epithelial tissue, and epithelial tissues do not have blood vessels. So there are no blood vessels in the top epidermis, but they are located in the underlying dermis. These are called cutaneous blood vessels, these vessels in the dermis of the skin. What is a bruise or an ecchymosis? And I won't ask you the term ecchymosis, we'll just call it a bruise. A bruise is actually where you bumped into something, you damaged the blood vessels in the dermis, the cutaneous blood vessels, they ruptured and they bled. So a bruise is actually hemorrhaging, which means bleeding of the cutaneous blood vessels. So when you have a bruise, it becomes all kind of red and purple. That's the red blood cells that have leaked out of the damaged blood vessels. And then over the next several days, it changes color to, you know, like orange and yellow and so on. And that's really the red blood cells being broken down and the chemicals reabsorbed by the body. Now, in most places in our body, wherever there are blood vessels, there are also lymphatic vessels. We're going to learn a lot more about lymphatic vessels in section P when we get to the lymphatic system. But I drew a picture. You've got it. Here's a blood vessel, a blood capillary. And we just mentioned that wherever you have blood vessels or blood capillaries, you usually have lymphatic vessels nearby. The purpose of the lymphatic vessels primarily is the following. Water tends to squirt out of blood capillaries, And that's because capillaries are very small, delicate vessels with a very thin wall, and the blood pressure inside these vessels causes water to squirt out. Now, if too much water squirts out, you get swelling or edema. Edema is just an accumulation of this fluid, and too much of this fluid accumulating in this area. So the function of these lymphatic vessels is to absorb this fluid that's squirted out of the blood capillaries, and the lymphatic vessel carries or conducts this fluid through the lymphatic system, which returns this fluid back to the bloodstream, back to the regular bloodstream. So exactly where these lymphatic vessels connect to the bloodstream and where that fluid returns back to the bloodstream is a subject we'll get to in section P. But the role of the lymphatic capillaries is to conduct or carry this fluid that's squirted out of the blood capillaries and to return that fluid back to the bloodstream. That takes us to nerve fibers in the skin. We have sensory neurons and motor neurons in most parts of our body. When we talked about skeletal muscle in section H on myology, we learned that there were sensory neurons associated with our skeletal muscle tissue called proprioceptors, associated with a sensory modality known as proprioception or kinesthesia. We also learned that there were somatic motor neurons that activate our skeletal muscle cells to contract. And in case you're thinking, when did you talk about that? That was in section H, and we did cover it. Similarly, there are both sensory neurons and motor neurons in our skin. Again, they are in our dermis, not in the epidermis. Among the sensory neurons that are in our skin, include thermoreceptors, which are sensitive to temperature, mechanoreceptors, which are sensitive to touch and pressure, and pain sensory neurons, which are commonly called nociceptors, that are activated whenever we injure our body, in this case, the skin. And when our skin is injured, it activates these pain sensory neurons, and it hurts. In addition, there are autonomic motor neurons that automatically control the glands and erector pili muscles and cutaneous blood vessels in the dermis of our skin. We actually covered this originally on page F1. If we return back to page F1, In this picture on F1, so you might recall that right here at the bottom, it points to an autonomic motor neuron that automatically can activate the erector pili muscle to contract, causing the hairs to stand upright. There are branches of the autonomic motor neuron that innervate this cutaneous blood vessel that can cause the blood vessel to either constrict or dilate. And we talked about cutaneous vasoconstriction or cutaneous vasodilation that is used to regulate temperature balance in the body. There are branches of the autonomic motor neuron that innervate the sebaceous or oil glands as well as the sweat glands. Now, because all of these structures are controlled automatically by our nervous system, we do not have voluntary control over them. We call these autonomic motor neurons that control this. We originally explained the difference between somatic motor neurons and autonomic motor neurons right here at the very top of page F1. And so I'm sure you wrote these notes already on the top of F1. Differentiating between somatic motor neurons, which control allow voluntary control over our skeletal muscles, versus autonomic motor neurons, which automatically control the internal organs of our body. All right, so back on page F6, we've spoken of sensory neurons and motor neurons in our skin. The last real anatomic topic I want to deal with the skin is our nails. And let's take a look at page F7. On page F7, so here's a picture of a nail. And the nail is actually made up of a protein called keratin. And it is pure keratin protein. Anybody know where else in our body we have something also made up of keratin besides our nails? Our hair. Our hair is made up of keratin protein. The only difference is that the keratin in our hair also contains pigments that might make it blonde or red or, you know, brunette or whatever, whereas the nails are pure, just keratin protein with no pigments. Now, the nail itself, made up of keratin, is almost translucent. That means it's not quite clear, but almost. It's kind of opaque or translucent. And that's why when you look at your nails, they look pinkish. And the reason why they look pinkish is the skin or nail bed underlying the nail has a lot of blood vessels in it. And really, we've told you before that the only cells in our body that the principal cells in our body that have any color to them are red blood cells. Most other cells in our body have no color. So the pink color of our nails is really because of the microscopic red blood cells circulating through these very tiny microscopic capillaries in our nail bed, in the skin. At the base of the nail, at least on some of your nails, especially the thumb, you might notice a kind of half-moon structure at the base called the lunula. And that's actually the area from which the nail is growing. So it's kind of growing upwards from that lunula area. Now, the nail is attached to the skin right around the edges. And the common term that we use is cuticle or cuticle fold. This anatomic or scientific name is eponychium. I know it's a weird word, but that's that holds the nail to the edges. In addition, the nail was attached at the front end. And if we look at this picture here, this is a kind of cutaway side view of the finger. And this is the nail. And it is attached right here onto the front end of your finger by a membrane called the hyponychium. Hypo means below or under, so right under the nail, that's holding the front of the front of the nail to the finger. Now, you might say, I don't really understand that, hyponychium. Let me try to explain it better. We've all had, at one time or another, we've gotten a sliver under our nail. And when that sliver, or a piece of wood or whatever, goes under our nail, it actually breaks that hyponychium and causes it to bleed. So if you've ever gotten something under your nail and it started bleeding, that means you punctured or broke that hyponychium membrane that holds the front end of the nail to the finger. All right, so everything I've just told you about the exciting world of nails was written at the bottom of F6, right here. We've talked about the eponychium, the hyponychium, and how the nail was made up of keratin. That takes us to page on F7. I want to speak briefly about pathologies associated with the skin. Now, this is not a course in pathology or disease, but I try to talk, for every system of the body, I try to give a few examples on the assumption that A, you're kind of interested in that since you want to go into a healthcare field, and B, I think it illuminates and helps us better understand the basic anatomy. Let's first talk about infections. What are infections? Infections are caused by microorganisms, microbes, that injure our body. Now, where you'll learn much more about microorganisms that cause infections is in microbiology, for those of you who have to take that. We're going to mention viral infections, bacterial infections, and fungal infections. First, let's start with a virus. What is a virus? Is a virus a living thing? So a virus is not a living thing. It's not a cell, and the cell is the basic unit of life. It's really just made up of two molecules, two organic molecules. They're extremely small, basically a virus, or what I prefer to call a viral particle, consists of a nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA, surrounded by a protein known as a capsid. And that capsid protein acts as an enzyme. Now, a viral particle, and there are viral particles floating around in the air right now, they're all around us, a viral particle on its own cannot do anything. It doesn't reproduce on its own, it doesn't respond to the environment, it doesn't do anything. A viral particle can only do one thing. It can enter a host cell. So if this is a viral particle, I show it entering a human cell. That's the only thing that a viral particle can do. Now, once the viral particle enters the human cell, what usually happens in the case of most viruses is that since human cells are designed to replicate DNA, right? Don't cells in our body normally duplicate or replicate DNA? The reason why they have to do that is before one human cell can divide into two human cells, it has to duplicate DNA. When this viral DNA enters the cell, our cell doesn't know that that's foreign or viral DNA. It simply sees DNA and it makes copies of it. So actually, after this virus enters the cell, it's your own cell that starts to make duplicate copies of that virus. And eventually, as this human cell fills up with more and more copies of this foreign DNA, this viral DNA, it causes the cell to rupture or undergo lysis. So in fact, we call these viruses lytic viruses. Bless you. Because the root lysis or lytic means to break apart. So basically what happens is when a virus enters a human cell, the human cell makes copies of it, and eventually that human cell ruptures or breaks apart. That's called lysis. So let's mention some examples of viruses that enter skin cells, because that's what we're talking about right now. Obviously, there are different viruses that enter liver cells or brain cells or other cells in the body. Smallpox. First of all, anytime you see that ending pox, it's a virus. So smallpox, chickenpox, and many of you are familiar with chickenpox or measles. These are common in children, and it causes sores on the skin. And these sores are where the virus has entered the skin cells and ruptured them. So that's what creates those sores, and they typically itch and so on. Measles, German measles, a cold sore. So we've all probably had a cold sore. That's where a virus enters our skin cells, causes those cells to rupture, break apart, and now it's all red, it hurts, it's sore, and that's called a cold sore, a fever blister. The name of these, you'll learn more about the names of these viruses for those of you who have to take a microbiology class. The cold sore is caused by herpes simplex. There is another herpes that can enter the cells of the genital area, and that causes genital herpes, sores around the genital area. Warts are caused by a virus that enters skin cells as well. So these viruses vary in their severity or virulence. Nobody dies from cold sores, or even for that matter, genital herpes. But in the case of smallpox, that's a very virulent virus that begins in the skin and spreads throughout the body. And many years ago, people used to die from smallpox until they developed a vaccine. Now, we do not really have effective antiviral drugs. You might say, well, why don't you just give somebody, if they have a virus, why don't you give them some penicillin? Let's think about what penicillin is. Penicillin is called an antibiotic. Have you ever thought about what the word antibiotic literally means? Against life. Antibiotic. If a virus is not alive, then taking an antibiotic can't kill it. Antibiotics are used to kill bacteria, but a virus is not a living thing. So antibiotics like penicillin or erythromycin are ineffective against viruses. So it's really up to your own immune system to destroy those viral particles. Now we can enhance or strengthen your immune system before you're exposed to the real virus. And this process of strengthening your immune system against a virus is called immunization or vaccination. So probably all of us have been vaccinated or immunized against various viruses. What they do is they actually give somebody an inactivated form of the virus. Now, I'm not saying it's dead because it was never alive. How do they inactivate it? Since the outer viral particle, the outer part of the viral particle is made up of a protein, if you can do anything that makes the protein unravel, so high temperatures, for example, can make the protein unravel. And it's that enzyme protein that allows the viral particle to enter your cells. So if you heat up these viral particles, that causes the outer capsid to kind of get all frayed and no longer work. And therefore, if we introduce these inactivated viral particles into your body, that's what it's called when you get vaccinated, they're not able to enter your cells. Since they cannot enter your cells, you shouldn't get sick. But then you might ask, well, so what good is it? They are in your body, and your white blood cells will see them. And when they see them, they increase in numbers. So this stimulates increased production of white blood cells and antibodies against the virus. So now, if you're ever exposed to the real virus, you have increased numbers of white blood cells and antibodies to fight those viral particles. So you have enhanced your immune response. That's why it's called, you've been immunized. All right, so much for some viral infections of the skin. Now, bacteria are living cells. They are the smallest of all living cells. We learned back in, when we were covering cytology in section B that they are prokaryotic cells, very small cells without a nucleus. The bacteria come in three basic shapes, kind of a round ball shape called a coccus, a rod shape called a bacillus, and a kind of a corkscrew shape called a spirillum. We're not going to get into the details of this. That's for a microbiology class. But on page F8, there are all kinds of bacteria that infect and injure different parts of your body. Now, first off, what are bacteria? How are they harming you? They are living cells. All living things need food. So if the bacteria is in your body, it's looking around and it's hungry. and it's thinking, I'm really hungry. What should I eat? I know, I'll eat this person. So that's what they're doing, is they're eating you up. They are parasites. They are parasites. Let's just make a note. That's what they are. They're parasites. They feed on you. Different bacteria feed on different parts of the body. Again, you'll learn more about that in micro. But let's mention a few bacteria that typically feed on the skin. So pimples and boils are actually typically caused by a bacteria called Staphylococcus aureus. We commonly call that a staph infection. This is just, we're not going to worry about memorizing that name, but they are coccus or round-shaped, ball-shaped bacteria that are feeding on the skin, and they're causing that area where they're feeding to get all injured and swollen and hurt and so on. So they are actually infecting the oil glands or sebaceous glands is where the infection is. Acne is caused by a different bacteria. Again, our purpose is not to memorize names of bacteria. That you can look forward to when you take micro. But there's a bacteria called Corine Bacterium acnes that causes acne. Another example of a bacterial infection is gonorrhea and syphilis. Now, gonorrhea and syphilis are known as STDs, sexually transmitted diseases, but they are bacteria that are feeding on the skin of the genital area, causing sores known as chancres or chancre sores. These are all examples of infections of the skin caused by bacteria feeding on the skin. Now, the good news about bacteria is that since they're living cells, you can kill them. So the drugs we use to kill bacteria are called antibiotics. Literally, it means against life. So what you learn in micro is you learn about different bacteria, and then later in your clinical courses, when you take a course in pharmacology, you will learn which antibiotics are effective against which kinds of bacteria. So if you're dealing with an aerobic gram-positive coccus bacteria, you can use something like penicillin V. But if you're dealing with an anaerobic gram-negative bacillus, you may have to use a different kind of antibiotic, like a tetracycline. So you'll learn all about that. A third type of infection that can occur anywhere in the body, but we're focusing on the skin, are fungal infections. Now, a fungus is a living thing. And just as an example of a fungus you're all familiar with is a mold growing on bread. So when you see a mold growing on bread, it's actually feeding on the bread, and it's growing. Some fungi can feed on you, including on your skin. So these are known as mycotic infections, and they cause athlete's foot. What athlete's foot is a fungus, very much like a mold, growing right between your toes, and it's feeding on your skin. It needs food. It's a living thing. It's hungry. Ringworm. Ringworm, I wrote, is a misnomer. It's misnamed. And I've used that word misnomer in the past. You might say, when did you ever use that word misnomer? When we talked about a broken hip. Remember, a broken hip is really not a broken pelvis. It's actually a break in the neck of the femur. So it's incorrectly called a broken hip. Well, ringworm is a misnomer. It's not a worm. It is simply a round pink area on the skin where a fungus is spreading. So they gave it the name ringworm, but it has nothing to do with any worm. It's a fungus. Crotch eczema, commonly known as jock itch. This is where a fungus is growing around the groin area. And another example of a fungal infection are vaginal yeast infections. Yeast is also a fungus. And so this is not uncommon for women to develop yeast infections in their vagina or birth canal. Now, you'll notice that where the fungi tend to thrive is where it's warm and wet. whether it's warm and wet between your toes or warm and wet between your thighs, that's where they tend to thrive. So one of the things that one needs to do to prevent the development and growth and spread of these fungal infections on the skin is to keep it cool and dry and not promote warm and wet for any length of time. There are antibiotics against fungi. These are very different antibiotics than those used to kill bacteria. An example that some of you have heard of is monistat, which is used to kill vaginal yeast infections, among other things. All right, now that we've talked about three types of infections of the skin caused by microbes, what are allergic reactions? An allergic reaction is a hypersensitivity to an innocuous agent. That just means that somebody is overly sensitive to something that's harmless. Innocuous means harmless. And you might ask, well, what do you mean something that's harmless, that somebody is overly sensitive to? So I wrote pollen, foods, and medicines. Many people have allergies. They're hypersensitive to pollen. Now, pollen are these microscopic spores floating around in the air. This is the way many plants reproduce. There's nothing harmful about pollen. Every time flowers bloom, they release pollen into the air. But some people are very overly sensitive, and when they inhale the pollen, their body reacts to it as if it was harmful. Most people, that doesn't happen, but it happens to some people. Some people have allergies or hypersensitivities to certain foods. When they eat wheat or eggs or strawberries, there are all kinds of different food allergies. There's nothing wrong with those foods, and most people don't have any problem eating them, but those who have allergies or are hypersensitive, their body reacts to it kind of very vigorously. And some people are even allergic to medicine. Is there anybody in this class allergic to penicillin? Now, is there anything wrong with penicillin? It's a fantastic antibiotic, but if you have an allergy to it, they're not going to give it to you because it would actually make you sick to give you penicillin. Now, there are many types of allergic reactions, and I'm just going to focus on hypersensitivity or allergic reactions that have manifestations on the skin. I'm going to skip eczema and psoriasis, so I'm going to skip those, but I do want you to know urticaria. Urticaria is the clinical word for hives, and for some people, when they have an allergic reaction, they break out in what are called hives or urticaria. Hives are simply splotchy red areas that itch. So they're raised, swollen, red areas on the skin that typically itch. That's called hives or urticaria. Let me give you, for those of you who don't have any known allergies, right? Some of us know we've got a lot of allergies, but I know that some of you don't have any allergies. If you would like to experience an allergic reaction, because you've never had the thrill of having an allergic reaction, there is something that everybody is allergic to. It's called poison ivy. So if you just take a walk out in the Santa Monica Mountains someday and just touch some of the shrubs, and there's enough poison ivy out there that eventually after you touch enough plants, you will brush against some of these leaves of the poison ivy plant and you'll start to break out in hives, and it's going to start to itch and it'll turn red. And then that's really an allergic reaction to something that's on the leaves of these plants. Now, as far as the treatment for an allergic reaction, what's actually causing the hives is the release of histamine. We learned about histamine back in Section D when we talked about mast cells. This was when we were learning about the very first connective tissue, a reeler or loose connective tissue. We've said before that of all the topics that we've covered for the first exam, the single topic we keep going back to more frequently than any other is histology. So we covered mast cells releasing histamine a long time ago. And we explained how it causes inflammation, redness, swelling, and pain. And that's really what the hives is. So you can take drugs called antihistamines that counteract the effect of histamine causing the redness, swelling, and pain. An example of an antihistamine is Benadryl. But what works even better against an allergic or hypersensitivity reaction are corticosteroids. And an example of a corticosteroid that many of you have used and sold over the counter is Cordate. So if you are bitten by an insect, you have an insect bite, if you have urticaria or hives from coming in contact with poison ivy, really Cordate is the very best thing you can do. That'll take away the redness, swelling, and pain. All right, what's listed next are moles, and I don't mean the little furry animal, and I don't mean Avogadro's number. A mole is a little, as we wrote, a pigmented elevation of the skin. And depending upon, that's also known as a birthmark. Now, depending upon where this pigmented elevation of the skin is, and it's really an abnormality, but depending upon where it is, people either consider it ugly and they want to remove it, or they consider it attractive and they'll call it a beauty mark. Now, I guess if somebody had this pigmented mole right at the tip of their nose, most people wouldn't consider that overly attractive, you know, for some reason. But apparently, if you have a mole on the upper lip, many people think that's attractive. And you might say, well, who has that? Cindy Crawford and Marilyn Monroe. And that's what in part made them famous. So that became known as a beauty mark rather than a birthmark. So it's whether we consider it attractive or not comes down to location. So in that respect, it's like real estate. You know, they say the value of real estate is location, location, location. All right, what is keratosis or skin tags? Now, this is more commonly seen in elderly people where you see these little skin tags, this little extra skin tags dangling from the skin on their arms and so on. I don't mean the extra loose skin, but just kind of a growth. And there's nothing harmful about these, but you do see these keratoses or skin tags in the skin of some elderly people. What are bed sores? Bed sores are clinically called decubitus ulcers. Now, the word ulcer, all that the word ulcer means is a sore. So most of us, when we see the word ulcer, we're thinking gastric ulcers in our stomach. That just means sores in our stomach. So any sore can be called an ulcer. A decubitus ulcer are sores on the skin that form in bedridden patients because of poor circulation. If somebody is just lying on their back and they don't move or don't rotate them periodically, they start to develop sores on their back because of poor circulation. Incidentally, if that ever happens in a patient, then that's grounds for a lawsuit because it means that nobody is caring for that patient. Because one of the jobs of a nurse is to rotate or turn that patient so they're not always lying in one place. You turn them to their side, you turn them on their tummy, you lay them on their back, but you never just let somebody lie in the same position day after day after day, or they will develop these decubitus ulcers. All right, cancer. We've learned about cancer back in section B when we were learning about cytology. We know that cancer can occur in any cell of the body. It's where cells become abnormal, transformed into abnormal cancerous cells that start dividing very rapidly, and then metastasizing or spreading through the body, forming more cancerous cells everywhere. Now, we have learned that if the cancer originates in an epithelial tissue, it's called a carcinoma. We learned that at the end of section D on histology. So an epithelial cancer is called a carcinoma. 80% of cancers originate in epithelial tissue. So we know that the epidermis, the top layer of skin, is an epithelial tissue. So if that becomes cancerous, skin cancer, that's called a carcinoma. The most aggressive carcinoma of the skin is when the melanocytes, the melanin-containing epithelial cells in the stratum germinativum, become cancerous. That's called a melanoma. And in case you're thinking, what did you just say about melanocytes? I don't think we covered that. It was on page F2, and yes, we did cover it right here on page F2. So, in fact, I even mentioned the word melanoma right at that time on F2. All right, so much for F8. On F9, what is albinism? Albinism is a genetic inability to make that brown-colored protein called melanin. So when somebody cannot make the brown-colored protein called melanin, that's they have no pigmentation at all. And they're not only is their skin very white, their hair is white, and their eyes are pink. So they just have to be very, very careful of ultraviolet rays from the sun, because they have no pigmentation in their skin to shield them from harmful ultraviolet rays. Since it's a genetic defect, a genetic disease, there's no cure or treatment. Now, it's not one of the worst diseases in the world, but there is no treatment. Jaundice. What is jaundice? Jaundice means yellowing of the skin, and what's causing the yellowing of the skin and the whites of the eye is a buildup of a chemical called bilirubin. So it's actually caused by a condition called hyperbilirubinemia. This is a good example of a clinical word. Emia means in the blood. Hyper means high amounts. So what are there high amounts in the blood? High amounts of bilirubin. Now, bilirubin is a chemical formed in your liver. We will learn more about bilirubin when we get to the liver. And we will explain even why jaundice tends to develop in many newborn babies. We'll explain all that. So we'll have to wait to explain more about what bilirubin is. But this kind of greenish-yellow chemical formed in the liver, when there's a buildup of it in the bloodstream, causes a yellowing of the body. It's most commonly, therefore, associated with liver problems. So usually jaundice is associated with liver diseases of the liver. Cyanosis. Cyan is the color blue. So if the person turns kind of bluish or cyanotic, that's due to hypoxemia. Another good clinical word. Emia means in the blood. Hypo means low, as opposed to hyper, meaning high. And what is there low amounts of in the blood? Oxygen. So when somebody isn't breathing well, and their oxygen levels in their bloodstream drop, they become cyanotic. Now, I'm going to talk about keloids in a moment, but before I cover keloids, let's talk about scar tissue in general. So, at the bottom of page F9, so let's first of all take a look at these two pictures right here on the right. What we're looking at is a side view of the skin. This is the epidermis, and this is the underlying dermis, which is much thicker than the epidermis. Let's imagine you cut yourself, right? You've got a paper cut or some other cut, and you've cut yourself into this skin. It's cut through the epidermis and even into the dermis. Assuming it's not a very deep or very wide cut, the dermis will grow back together, and the epidermis will grow back together, and within a matter of days, your skin looks good as new. And we've all cut ourselves, and the skin heals back together very nicely. Now, let's look on the two left-hand pictures. Let's imagine that somebody had a very deep cut or a very wide gash. When somebody has a really deep, wide cut, you should actually have stitches. What stitches are is when they use a threads or some similar material, suture material, to cause the two cut edges of the skin to be drawn back together again to facilitate or promote healing. What if somebody should have had stitches but they didn't? So what happens then is that the dermis actually grows faster than the epidermis. Now, you might say, well, why would the dermis grow faster than the epidermis? Their blood vessels are in the dermis. There are no blood vessels in the epidermis. So the nourishment to the dermis is better than it is to the epidermis. So if it's a very wide, deep cut, the dermis grows much faster than the epidermis. And if we look at this picture here, can you see that the dermis has grown to the surface? In other words, imagine the dermis grew right together, and it actually grew right to the surface right here. So now, and there's no epidermis right there. We call that a scar. That's what a scar is. A scar is where the dermis has reached the surface of the skin and there is no overlying epidermis. That's why the scar has a different color. It doesn't have hair. It's just typically different than the epidermis than when it grows together. So that's what a scar is. Now that we know what a scar is, and incidentally, what's the tissue that makes up the dermis? Do you think I'm going to ask you that on the second exam, especially since I asked you that on the first exam? The dermis we learned back on page, most recently, F3, is made up of irregularly arranged dense fibrous connective tissue. We originally covered that on D11. Now, does anybody know what type of tissue scar tissue is made of?
It's the same thing.
It's the exact same thing. Obviously, it's the same thing. That's what I just explained right here. And we wrote that on the bottom of D11. If you were to look back on D11 at the very bottom, you would see that we gave you two examples of irregularly arranged dense fibrous connective tissue. The first was dermis of the skin, and the second was scar tissue. So we definitely want you to know that. This is the third time we're covering this. We covered it originally on D11, we covered it then on page F3, and now we're covering it again.
Question? Are there any blood vessels in its scar tissue?
There would be blood vessels, yes. Now that we've explained what a scar is, we can explain what a keloid is. In some people, when they form a scar, that's right here, it starts to grow and it sticks up. It's elevated or raised higher than the rest of the skin, and it even starts to spread over the epidermis. That's called a keloid. So a keloid is an enlarged scar. And we wrote that right here under keloid. It's simply it results from injury or trauma to the skin. And it's an enlarged scar. And it may grow quite large. For some reason, this is more common in individuals with darker skin. Don't know why. But those are called keloids, just an enlarged scar. And finally, on page F10, the last topic as we wrap up section F are burns. Now, the idea of burns, most of us are somewhat familiar with this because we've heard the term first degree, second degree, and third degree burns. So what is a first degree burn? A first degree burn is where the epidermis has been destroyed, just the top epidermis. And that can happen from a sunburn. So some of you have had a sunburn, you've been lying out in the sun, and it burns just the top epidermis. And it causes pain. And it turns red. There may be peeling of the skin, but usually it heals okay. Usually it heals all right. What is a second degree burn? A second degree burn means that it's burned off not only the epidermis, but partway into the dermis. So it's an intradermal burn. It's burned also part of the dermis. Not completely, but part of it. An example of a second degree burn would be coming in contact with scalding hot water. So with scalding hot water, it's also very painful, it blisters. So you typically have blistering. There is usually the skin heals in 2 to 3 weeks, although there may be some scarring. What is a third degree burn? A third degree burn is a complete burn of the skin. There is no skin. It's burned through not only the top epidermis, but completely through the dermis. There is no skin. So this happens with direct contact with fire, or flame, with a high electrical voltages, or chemicals, very corrosive chemicals like acids. So then it can burn through the entire skin. That's a third degree burn. Very strangely, you'll notice it says it may be painless. And the reason why it might be painless is because you burned off all the sensory neurons. There's no sensory neurons. So that's not necessarily a good sign that you don't feel anything. Depending upon how large of a third degree burn there is, it may require grafting of skin. Now, in the old days, they used to graft skin from cadavers, dead people's skin. They would graft pig skin from a pig. Today, what they usually do is an autograft. That's not an autograph where you sign your name, but an autograft. Let's say if somebody had third-degree burns, let's say, on their face, they can take skin from their back and they grow it in a tissue culture, like in an aquarium tank. They can grow more of it, and then they can place it right over where the third-degree burn is on the face. Obviously, this is the best solution to grafting skin for two reasons. Most importantly, there's no organ transplant rejection. It's your own body, rather than transplanting skin from somebody else. Secondly, cosmetically, it's obviously going to look more like your own skin because it is your skin. It won't look exactly perfectly because even the skin on our face is different from the skin on our back.